So I remember learning in medical school that measles has fever and then those three C's, the cough, runny nose, and conjunctivitis, and then the rash comes later. But that looks like a lot of the different viral infections that I see in primary care in kids. I know the rash looks a little bit different, but until that point, I imagine it's pretty hard to tell measles from other viruses.
Not hard at all. When children come into our hospital, Children's Hospital of Philadelphia, and there's a suspicion of measles, they ask older people like me to come down and take a look, because honestly, I can tell within 30 seconds whether somebody has measles.
And 1 in 5 kids with measles were hospitalized.
You're right. I mean, measles causes congestion, runny nose, and rash, and pink eye. And the rash usually starts at sort of the hairline here and then spreads down to the face, the trunk, and then out to the arms and legs. And the rash is the so-called measles-like rash, but there are rashes that look similar. So you could argue, how do you distinguish fever and a rash in someone who has measles from fever and a rash and these other viral infections that can do the same thing? And the way that you do that is children with measles are sick. You can really tell within 30 seconds of walking in the room who has measles and who doesn't, because children with measles are miserable.
And then there are long-term complications from measles that we don't see with many routine childhood illnesses.
That's right. So measles causes the rash we all know about, but it also can cause severe and occasionally fatal pneumonia. Measles can also infect your brain. And every year in this country, before there was a measles vaccine, which was first available in the early 1960s, we would see 48,000 hospitalizations with measles, and we would see 500 deaths from measles. But there's one long-term complication of measles that I think few people know about, and it has the fancy name subacute sclerosing panencephalitis. And that's just a progressive neurological degeneration. Initially, it starts as sort of poor handwriting, and then eventually and invariably progresses to death. And once that symptom cascade starts, it's inevitable that it's a fatal outcome.
But the measles vaccine is a live vaccine. So I would imagine that some parents would worry that they could have that SSPE complication from the vaccine. We don't see that, though.
No, the key is not just live, it's live attenuated. So it is a highly, highly weakened form of the virus. So it induces the immunity that's a consequence of the natural infection without having to pay the price of natural infection. And it worked. I mean, measles is the most contagious of the vaccine-preventable disease. I mean, if someone comes into our hospital and they are into one of the rooms in the emergency department, no one can go in that room for another 2 hours until all those tiny little droplets settle. Right. But nonetheless, we were able to eliminate measles from this country by the year 2000. Unfortunately, measles has to some extent come back because a critical number of parents have chosen not to vaccinate their children.
The contagiousness is what worries me the most. As a primary care doctor, as you mentioned, it hangs out in the air for a while. And if you're not vaccinated and you're in the same space as someone with measles, 9 out of 10 of those people will contract measles, which is unlike any other infection that's in my waiting room, which is so scary because there have been periods in time where many people are not getting the measles vaccine. And we see outbreaks even in the U.S. because people travel.
You're right. It's frightening. I take a disease like smallpox, which was fatal 30%+ of the time, but that was spread by large droplets. You really need to have face-to-face contact with someone with smallpox to get that disease. For coronavirus, for this virus, the COVID virus, it's generally small droplets. So again, you need to be fairly close to somebody who has that that virus and then is spreading it by talking or sneezing or coughing. Measles is spread by aerosol. So it's very, very tiny droplets that can hang in the air like a ghost before they settle down. And that's what makes that virus so remarkably contagious.
In 2019, we saw some of the highest rates of measles in the United States since the early 90s. And we think that some of that is due to people refusing the vaccine. During the pandemic, though, with social distancing, we were distancing and we didn't see measles, thankfully. But I do worry that as we start coming back together again, that we might see measles coming back.
Oh, I think you're right. I think what worries me actually is that because of this pandemic, children have become under-vaccinated for a variety of potential infectious diseases. And I really do feel that as we all now get back together again and unmask and don't social distance, that you're going to see some of these vaccine-preventable diseases come roaring back in that group that is unvaccinated.
Mm-hmm. And you're right that we forget about how serious measles is because many people who were born after the vaccine haven't seen it. And it does feel like something that was just in a textbook. But as you mentioned, these kids get so sick that it's something that we can't forget about.
I think you're right. I think at some level, vaccines have become a victim of their own success. And when you see some young parents today say, you know, I'll take the measles every time, it tells me that not only have we largely eliminated measles from this country, I think we've eliminated the memory of measles, because measles makes you sick.